It's a pleasure to start this eighth school, no? On statistical field theory.
Ninth.
Okay, I missed one. This ninth school on statistical field theory. The first speaker is Marie Carmen Banuls from Max Planck Institute in Garching, and she will talk about tensor network states. Please, Marie Carmen, the stage is yours. Just go on.
Well, thank you very much. So first of all, thanks for the invitation to participate in the school. And yeah, as Andrea said, it's a shame that it cannot be in person, but well, at least it's the best we can have in these times. So it's great to anyway have you all here and have the chance to talk to you about this topic that for me is very, yeah, very interesting and yeah, a lot of fun. So I want to give you a bit of an introduction to these tensor network states. There's a lot of things to tell about this, but my perspective is mainly numerical. I work in algorithms and how to use them for quantum many body systems. So there will be a bit of this flavor in what I'm telling you, but my hope is to give you a bit of an overview of what's around, so that if you are interested, you could also find where to read more and where to go into more depth in the subject. So usually this is sort of the plan that I follow in this kind of lectures, where I would introduce what the tensor networks are and the families and then talk about numerical algorithms. But I'm planning to do it a bit slightly differently today, so that it is not so linear and hopefully it will be a bit more interesting and a bit more fun. And I know it's more difficult to follow a lecture or a talk via Zoom than in person. So I hope that in this way it will be more, yeah, so easier to get the ideas and maybe, yeah, more enjoyable too. So anyway, I copied here a QR code, which is a code to the notes that anyway I think are shared in the webpage of the school. So these are just my own notes that I prepare to follow more or less the logic of the lecture, but it's mostly about the more theoretical part, the part that presents the different families and their properties and so on. The algorithms are not included there, but there is a lot of references so that you can also see where the algorithms are presented, or at least in a pedagogical way. So this is more or less the plan that I'm intending to follow these days, which is giving you the general idea why is it interesting to look at tensor networks and what they are. And then for today, I would like to present you the main character, which is the matrix product states. And then go into one of the algorithms, which is the TBD algorithm. And I write here is the Swiss knife of tensor networks, because you can use it to do a lot of the basic things that people use tensor networks for, like ground states and some dynamics, thermal equilibrium states, open systems. So I won't have time to explain all these things today, but hopefully between today and tomorrow, we will sort of cover this. And also tomorrow, I'd like to go a bit more into the properties of matrix product states that make them so interesting, and other algorithms that one can do with them, especially the variational search, which is basically the MRG, and talk about also matrix product operators. And then the other families I will leave for the last day, and then we will talk a little bit about PEPs and also other tensor networks that one can construct depending on how time goes also. So I'm happier if we don't cover all the material, but people ask a lot of questions and follow whatever we are discussing. So, well, that's it. And unless there is some questions, of course, please feel free to interrupt me at any moment and ask any question. And otherwise, let's just start. Well, this is, of course, I forgot. This is a bit of a list of the references. Not all of them are here, but anyway, in the notes, you have a more extensive bibliography. So I would ask you to look in there rather than copy these references now. But anyway, since you will have a copy of the slides or of the talk, you can check the references later. So, okay, what are tensor networks, right? So what is the background? So tensor networks, actually, people have discovered them in different fields in the literature, but for all the purposes of what I'm telling you about today, the context I'm interested in is that of quantum many-body systems, right? So we are trying to describe quantum many-body systems, and mostly systems on a lattice. So we can think of a system which is a spatial lattice. For instance, let's consider a regular two-dimensional lattice like this. And in each of the sides of the lattice, of course, it could be on the edges too. It doesn't really matter. We have one quantum system. And this quantum system has some physical physical Hilbert space, which we call it H. And well, it has a dimension, which we typically call small d. And then we can write a basis, which we can label in different ways, but without any loss of generality, we could just label them with numbers up to d minus one, if we start in zero. For instance, of course, we could have a 0-1 basis for a spin 1/2 particle or for a qubit. And well, this lattice, I just draw a rectangular lattice, but it could also be one-dimensional, of course. It could be a chain, or it could be something else like an hexagonal, so honeycomb lattice, or something which is actually not regular at all. So whatever we can think of. So we are interested in problems that have this kind of structure. And for instance, we could be interested in models like the easing model, right? So spin chains, if you want, something like Sigma-Z, where each particle is a spin 1/2 particle that interacts with the nearest neighbors. And this is like the paradigmatic model to study quantum phase transitions. Or, well, we can look at the Heisenberg model. So this I plus one, something like this, which is like a model for magnetism. We can add other terms. Oops, sorry. I just changed the. So we can add other terms and try to study like integrability issues or whatever. So this is the kind of problems we are typically interested in. And what we want to do is to solve them. And solve them means maybe finding the ground state or maybe finding some excited state, some thermal properties. So in many of these cases, so not in this one that I wrote in here, but it's not in one of them, but in many of these cases, we cannot use analytical methods. So if we can use analytical methods, well, then we can solve the problem, right? So that would be precisely what solvable model means. But this is only for very few cases, very special cases, and otherwise only for models in which we can use these analytical methods as sort of a basis for some perturbation theory. So it would be only applicable in, say, special limits. So in most cases, so in the general case, we don't have that, and we have to use numerical methods. So it is very interesting from the point of view of quantum manual physics to have numerical methods that are capable to solve, in principle, arbitrary problems, right? So the problem with numerical methods is that if we have this kind of model that I wrote in here, if we have these physical systems which have this physical Hilbert space with a dimension small d, well, the dimension of the full problem of the whole system with all these quantum systems that interact with each other, this grows exponentially with the number of components, right? So the whole dimension would be the dimension of one of them to the power of the number of constituents, say, number of components. And this means that that it's a very big problem. So the complexity in general of the problem grows exponentially with the size of the system. So we can have different methods, or we have a group or various, several groups of important numerical methods that we use to solve these problems. So the first one is do exact diagonalization. Which is precisely what the name says. So we take this Hamiltonian and we look for the eigenstates, right? So we solve the eigenvalue problem. The problem here is that, of course, this exponential dimension means that our capability to solve this exactly is limited by the size of the problem, because we cannot fit extremely large matrix in a computer to do the diagonalization. So there is a limit in there, and up to now, the limit, depending on the model, but basically you can think that we can solve in this way problems that have up to 30 or 40 spins, in the case of spin 1/2 particles. And I mean, one can push the limit a little bit by, for instance, exploiting symmetries in the problem, so doing a lot of smart tricks. But at the end, the complexity grows exponentially. So we cannot double the number of spins that we can solve with one of these, so with an exact diagonalization. Another very big group of methods that we use in here when we cannot use exact diagonalization is quantum Monte Carlo. So in quantum Monte Carlo, in quantum Monte Carlo algorithms, we can deal with much larger systems. So when it works, it allows us to do thousands of spins, but it has limitations. And the limitations come because of the sign problem in Monte Carlo calculations. So for instance, when we have fermions, or when we have frustration, then the problem, so the generic problem is that one can have contributions with different sign that have to adapt to something very small, for instance. And it is very difficult for the algorithm to converge to that. It takes very, very long. It takes a very large sample to have convergence. So you recover somehow the exponential problem. So when the Monte Carlo calculation works, it allows us to do very large systems, and it's very powerful, but it's limited in some cases. And then another big branch of numerical methods that we have at hand are precisely these tensor network methods, or say DMRG-like methods. And this is what I'm going to talk to you about today. So we use for talking about tensor networks, we use a graphical representation, which comes up very handy to describe the algorithms, to explain the concepts, and it simplifies life a lot. Even though at the very end, when one wants to implement or prove something, often one has to sit down and work out all the indices with a lot of care. But actually, even demonstrations, so mathematical proofs, can be done in the pictorial representation. So let me just take a couple of minutes to explain how this works, in case you haven't seen these pictures around. So first of all, what is a tensor, right? So a tensor in this context is simply an object which has several dimensions. So we would say it's a multidimensional array. So for instance, a matrix is a two-dimensional array. A tensor is something which has more or an arbitrary number of indices. Graphically, what we do is to represent this as, say, a box. It could also be a circle, doesn't really matter. Let's call this tensor T, and it has a number of legs. Say, for instance, like this. And these legs correspond to each of the open indices. So if I give values to the legs, this would be one component of the tensor. For instance, I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. And if I don't give the values, so if I just draw the object with the open legs, this means the whole tensor, so all the components. And see that in here, there's a number of things that are not necessarily defined. For instance, it doesn't really matter in which direction I draw the indices, the legs. Or for instance, it's not specified what happens or how do I represent a conjugate tensor. But I will talk about this whenever it's necessary. Oh, one thing that I didn't say is that, of course, in this object, not all the legs need to have the same dimension. So these guys could have dimensions D1, D2, until D5. So, oops, sorry, D5. And the dimension of this object is, of course, the product of all of them, right? So the product of all the DIs. So this is completely general. So this is what in this language is a tensor. So what is the simplest example? Well, the simplest example is a vector, right? A vector is a tensor with one index. So say D, which has components VI. Well, this would be the representation of a vector, for instance, like this. And this would mean all the components, right? As I said before, all the VIs, say from I equal to 0 to D minus 1, if the vector has dimension D. One step beyond is a matrix, right? A matrix, it's a tensor with two indices now, and let's call it M, something like this. In particular, say one example of a matrix would be the identity. So the identity matrix is represented like just a line. And this just means that if I take values for the indices, I see this as a tensor with two indices, it has two open legs. This is just a delta of both indices. And this can be generalized to something like this, which is like a copy tensor. Let me just generalize. For something like a delta with three legs. And if I give indices values to the indices I, j, k, this would be something like a delta of all of them, I, j, k. So in general also, this is some convention that we use in these diagrams, that when a tensor is diagonal, well, in this case, it doesn't even appear here because there is nothing but a copy, but we could also sometimes draw something like a solid small circle, like a dot in the middle of the tensor. That, for instance, could be some tensor which is diagonal, such that Mij is equal to some value Mi delta Ij. This is just part of the graphical notation that appears often in the tensor diagrams. Okay, so when we have this...
Excuse me, Mari
yes,
Carmen.
Yes.
There is a question from the chat.
Ah, okay. Yeah, thanks. Okay. Let me see. Yeah, thanks for letting me know, because if I'm not looking, then I don't notice. Right. Do arrows going in and out of the black box have a meaning, or is it just for pictorial purposes? Well, it depends. So there is not a unique way in which people use this, but yes, often people use arrows going in and out, mostly in the context of symmetries. So when one thinks of, I'm not talking about this much, I will mention it sometime later in the talks, but of course these indices, they live in some bases, right? So one can think of bases which have well-defined quantum numbers, and then that have like whatever charges, and they can have an SU2 label, say, and then to define composition of these legs, you need to define ingoing and outgoing indices. So in these cases, then the people sometimes resort to these arrows going in and out, but not everybody uses them. So it's not a unique way of using them, I would say. So, but it can be used. So it can be exploited to make the pictures more descriptive. Okay, let me see. There's something else in the chat. Do tensor networks suffer from sign problem or not? We often say they don't suffer from a sign problem. And this is because when you contract, say, an expectation value with a tensor network, that doesn't have a sign problem. However, you could define sampling over a tensor network in which you could come up with a sign problem. But usually we say it doesn't, because it doesn't have the same so the calculations go in a very different way, which I will explain, than quantum Monte Carlo. So they are not, for instance, a more precise answer would be that you can deal with fermions with them and with frustrated systems the same as you do with say spins or systems without frustration. How large can n side degree of freedom be with tensor network methods? So N, so I'm using N, or I was using N before for the system size, so the number of sites, but I understand, but please correct me, that the question is about the physical dimension, the local dimension of the quantum systems that intervene in here. Anyway, so both of them can be asked. So the physical dimension, which is what I'm calling small d, like say in here, like this small d, is the dimension of one of the legs. There's not really a limit, but when we think about these definitions that I'm presenting here, it has to be a finite dimension. That's one thing. But then, of course, the cost of the calculations depend on how big this this dimension is, and they increase polynomially with however large this becomes. So that's a true limitation, that it has to be finite. But if you think of what people have done, and you look at the literature and actual calculations with tensor networks, people have used physical dimensions that are of the order of hundreds. So then the computation is more costly, but it can be useful in some cases. For instance, I'm thinking in the context of numerical renormalization group. I know that people have used this with success. So the only limitation is that it has to be finite for defining these families that I'm talking about. And if it is about the how many sites you can put in there is no limit. So actually we can work directly in the thermodynamic limit. But if you are doing finite systems, then the cost scales polynomially with the system size, typically very well. So typically it's even linearly, but then it's still scaling. Although strictly speaking, there is no limit. I hope this answers the question. But if not, yes. Okay.
The last part was truly answering my question.
It was about the system. Okay. Yes.
Yes. Yes. So the exact diagonalization can go to 30, 40.
Okay.
Quantum right. Monte Carlo to about 1,000, and this can go to the thermodynamic limit.
Yes, but if you go to the thermodynamic, so to be totally honest, if you work directly in the thermodynamic limit, then you are putting some more bias in your ansatz, because what you do is that you consider that all your tensors are the same, or a bunch of tensors is repeated, right? So you are putting some extra information, say, in the... I mean, I haven't described yet what I'm talking about, but okay, I'll try to go back to that if I remember. But let's say that if you do finite tensor networks, then I would say it's also thousands of sites, what would people have done. And if you go beyond that, then you go to the thermodynamic limit, and it's also very powerful, but then it has an extra part of, so you put some extra guess on how your state looks like to be able to do that. Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot for the questions. So let's continue. So this is a picture of like basic tensors. Now with tensors, to construct tensor networks, one has to put tensors together. And this is actually taking contractions. So a contraction is just contractions. So a contraction is just a product between two tensors, so over a certain index. So the simplest case is, say, take a scalar product of two vectors, so vector times vector. And this gives you a scalar. And graphically, what this is you take two vectors, say u and v, and you join them with one common leg. So this object here doesn't have any open indices, and this represents precisely a scalar. No open index is a scalar, which is a tensor with no legs. And the components are precisely, well, the components of the scalar product, the sum of products of components of the vectors, right? And this is actually what a contraction means. A contraction means. And you can do this over any leg of a pair of tensors. So a matrix vector multiplication, which is the next example, next logical example, would be something like this, right? And this gives you now an object. So if you see this as a whole tensor, of course, any set of tensors that are connected like that, you can see like from outside, like how many open legs are there here? And if you see this as a single tensor, you see that there is a single open leg as corresponds to the product of a matrix times a vector. So this is a vector. And then, of course, you can do matrix, which would look like this, right? M times N, matrix. and so on. And in general, you could just say, I have tensors with a number of legs. And then I can have a contraction by joining legs in some particular way, for instance, like this. And this will be an object that has some open indices and the others are contracted. So one important question is, what is the cost of doing these calculations? And this is important from the point of view of the algorithms to know if they are efficient or not, right? And the cost of the algorithms at the end is typically boiled down to computing how many of these elementary operations among tensors you are doing, these contractions. So it is important to consider whenever you are thinking of computations with tensor networks, whether they are efficient or not, and how the cost grows with your system of your problem and the dimensions that you put in there. So how do you compute the cost of these operations? Well, it's very easy because, say, what is the cost? So the cost is typically estimated in the number of elementary operations that one needs to do. So for this first example, if the dimension of these guys was small d, as I was writing before, so the cost of computing this contraction is how many of these elementary operations we need to do. And the elementary operations are taking the product of two components or taking a sum, right? And you see that in here, we are just taking the product of d components and summing them. So the cost of this contraction is precisely of the order of the dimension of the objects. Now, if you have a product of a matrix times a vector, you have to do one contraction like that per component of the resulting vector, right? So if the dimension, say, of our matrix and vector were d1 and d2, and now I'm changing the notation from the small d to capital D. And let me just note here that often for the tensor networks, we use capital D to denote dimensions of the tensors when these dimensions are part of the answers, as you will see. So, okay, I will be using capital D's all over the place. So, okay, what is the cost of this contraction, matrix vector contraction? So I said that for each element of the resulting vector is the number of components that I'm taking the product of, so this d2. So the total cost is the product of both, d1 times d2. And if I go to a matrix times a matrix, d1, d2, d3, because they don't need to have the same dimensions, of course, well, I have to do this elementary product, so like a column of one matrix times a row of the other, I have to do the number of components that my final matrix has, right? So then it's like d1 times d2 times d3. And for a general contraction like the one I drew down here, then it's just the product of the product of dimensions that are open times the product of dimensions that are contracted. Right? So it's important that the contracted dimensions do not appear twice, they only appear once, because this is precisely the number of elementary operations that we are doing to compute one of the components outside. Okay, so one last comment about these contractions is that, as I said before, there is no unique way in this graphical notation to denote when we take the adjoint of a matrix, for instance, or the transpose of a matrix. For instance, I drew here the matrix product, the product of two matrices, but if I would want to write the product of the, say, transpose of one of these matrices times the other, I would just simply indicate it in the say, explicit name of the tensor or something like that. There is not a unique way of doing that. At least not in general. Okay. Okay, no, I heard something, but it was something else. So just a small quiz for 2 minutes. So looking at these diagrams, one can draw a lot of things. So can you guess what this diagram represents here if M is a matrix, of course? Three trace. Okay, very good. So yeah, how do I do this? A bit like this, no? Yes. Right, so of course, it's like the trace of the matrix, right? Very good. So exactly, that's the trick of the matrix. If we would say, okay, what is the first one? The first one would be m times m dagger. As I said, we don't have a unique way of doing m times m dagger. And m times the identity, of course, is just the same diagram as for m, but you can just make it longer to show that explicitly, that there is a say an identity added to that. Okay. And let me just comment in here that if we, instead of a matrix, would have something higher dimensional that has more indices. So I can call it, I'll call it T so that it doesn't look like a matrix. So I can do something like that, taking a trace on just one of the indices. So this would be like a partial trace, the way we take a partial trace. Okay, to be able to do this operation, of course, the dimension of this leg has to be the same as the dimension of this one. Okay, very good. So tensor networks are a way of talking about quantum systems that is very related to how much entanglement we have in them. So let me just talk a little bit about what we mean by that. And I hope I didn't forget to tell you anything about the notation. No, I think we are fine. Right. And so what is the basic idea that we use to, I mean, of course, entanglement is a complicated subject, but the two key concepts that we use a lot when talking about tensor networks. So as I said, the goal is to describe a quantum system which is multipartite. It's made out of many components. And so let's consider something which is bipartite. So we have a system which has two parts, A and B, and each of them has a Hilbert space, say with some, correspond to some dimension. So HA, HB. And well, each of them has, of course, a basis. We will call them just with a subindex, but I'm not using different names in here. I hope this is not too confusing. Yes. And then the total Hilbert space, the state of the system lives in the product of these two, right? The tensor product. So we can just write a basis, which is taking the product of all the JB. I think I changed the notation here. Of all the elements in one. Sorry, I'm using this one. Minus one, and in the second one. So an arbitrary state of the system, so I'm calling S the total system, so a state of the whole system, we can always write in these bases as a linear combination of all the elements in these product bases, right? And well, one particular case would be product states. So if the state is a product, so let me call it phi is, yeah, like this, which is a product, right? This we can always write as a direct, so a tensor product of one state in A and one state in B. I'm just calling them with a subindex now here. That, okay, let me just change, maybe call this one phi. But in general, this is not the case, right? In general, we have a state which is a linear combination of all the elements in the basis, and not necessarily can be written as a product. So what we can always do to analyze how close to a product this state is, or how not a product it is to look at its Schmidt decomposition. And the Schmidt decomposition is nothing but the singular value decomposition of the matrix of coefficients. Okay, what is the matrix of coefficients? The matrix of coefficients here is precisely all the coefficients of the state. This, if you see, has two indices, I and j. So in the language of tensors, it's a tensor with two indices. And then I could just draw it like this. See, with two indices. And for any matrix, we can write the composition, which is what we call the singular value decomposition, which has this form. Let me write it in general here. So for any matrix M, we can write it as a product of, say, a unitary matrix, a diagonal positive matrix, and another unitary. So this is diagonal and positive. Well, I didn't say it's real, but of course, to be positive, it has to be real. Diagonal, real, and positive. And U and V dagger are actually, rather than unitaries, they are isometries, because this works also for rectangular matrices, so they do not need to be square. They could be rectangular isometries. And what this means is that, say, U dagger U is the identity, and U dagger is a projector. This is what it means. So it's like basically a part of a unitary. So how does this look like? Well, if M was a matrix, let me just draw it like an abstract matrix that was dimensions, say, D1 times, okay, let me just make it a bit more different. D1 times D2, right? So this is our matrix M. This decomposition looks like U could be D1 times D1 unitary. S, we can write as a diagonal, which is basically D1 diagonal, but we can make it zeros outside. And then we could write V dagger as a D2 times D2 unitary. In this case, it would be full unitary, but because there is only up to D1, I'm just drawing D1 smaller than D2. There's only D1 values in the diagonal that are different from zero, because of course we cannot have more than the rank of the matrix, and the rank cannot be larger than the smaller dimension. So there is only there is a bunch of columns that are just zero, and we could as well take out the corresponding part, so to this part of V dagger. So if we cut V dagger in that way, then we have something which looks like part of a unitary, and this is precisely what an isometry is. So explained in quite a rough manner. Okay, this is just general. Okay, this works for any matrix, and this is called the singular value decomposition. And it's like probably the most useful routine in linear algebra that we use for tensor network algorithms, or the most used one. There's also others that we use often, but say the singular value decomposition is very fundamental to all these algorithms. Okay, so what does this have to do with entanglement? Well, it turns out that it has a lot to do with the decompositions that we use. And going back to our state written as a linear combination of basis states into systems, or into bases of the part A and part B of our system, this is C is now a matrix, and we can write it in this singular value decomposed way. And explicitly, I'm using the same notation as I did in the note. So explicitly, I would write this as a product. So C would be a product of, say, okay, let me write the components before, although this is opposite to what I was saying I would do. Say SKK, V dagger, KJ. You see, I just wrote that for C, so put C in the place of M before, and just wrote explicitly the sum over the internal indices between U, S, and V dagger. Taking into account that S is diagonal, as I said before, right? So in pictures, let me draw it also, since we are already using this pictorial representation. What I would say is that I can write this C as a product of three things. One of them is U, one of them is S, and one of them is V dagger, and their matrix is like this. Now, because S is diagonal, we often do this that I was saying before and represent it like something like this. And because U and V dagger are isometries, it is often the case that we represent them with triangles. But this is not always the case. So you can see it. Okay, let me just do it as a different equation so that I don't make a mess in here. So often you will see something like this to represent a singular value decomposition. This would be U, V dagger, and S. Okay, so this is the graphical representation of all what I'm doing here with indices. You start seeing probably why it is convenient to work with the graphical representation. So now if we substitute this C decomposition into the state, well, this is just the sum over K of, say, S K. I'm just dropping one of the indices because it, or let me just use both. And I'm grouping things together. I can put the U, all the terms that are summing over I together, and all the terms that are summing over J together. And this was P dagger K J J B. And you see, this is just a state. Say, this is a state in A. I could call it a UKA. And this is a state of B, which I can call VKB. And now what I have is that my state is written in, say, with a diagonal of coefficients, this S case, right? So this is precisely the Schmidt decomposition. And well, because the singular value decomposition is a unique one up to permutations of values that can be degenerate. Also, the Schmidt value, the Schmidt decomposition is a diagonal one. And now you can use this to look at entanglement properties. But let me just talk about, let me just write it here. AK, SKK, UKA, BK, B. Let me just talk a little bit about what this means, because I think it is important to have this picture in mind. See, in the graphical representation, what I said is that my state psi, which was first C, and often when we are talking about the states, we will draw the indices just pointing all up or all down, all the physical indices. Now this is a tensor, right, that describes the state of a two-body system. So what I did is a decomposition that splits one leg with respect to each other, and often we draw it that way. And now it looks like this. Say, you can just write it like this. Like that. But you see, this U and B dagger, they are just unitary transformations. So they are just changing the basis. So somehow, this diagonal here contains all the information of my state, right? In a way, it's the state written in a particular basis. So I need to do the singular value decomposition to figure out what that basis is. And now I know everything about my state. So, okay, now what's this Schmidt decomposition good for? Well, we can use this to compute or to just read the reduced density matrix for one part of the system. So the reduced density matrix, say, is the state of the part A, so the partition A of my system, which is just the result of tracing out all the rest, so tracing out partition B. So I take my state, and it's adjoint, and trace out B. And well, you can see, well, this, okay, explicitly, this means taking some basis of B, the basis J that we had defined before, and some overall, so some discontraction over all the states of the basis, right? B. And you can see, if you do that, okay, let me just do it graphically, that this would be, okay, maybe I change the color. Well, as I said before, connecting together the index B, say, okay, this was A, this was B. I'm trying to go a bit slower. This represents psi. Again, as I said before, we don't have a unique way of representing adjoints, but often when we are talking about the states, what we do is we reverse the direction of the indices. Okay? Right. So if we do that, you can immediately see, right, that that the result of computing the reduced density matrix of my, we could even do it graphically, right? So, okay, let's do it graphically. So I substitute now my singular value decomposition in here. And what I'm doing here is to trace out these guys. But because this thing is an isometry, V dagger times V is the identity, so I can just remove this part. So substitute this by identity. And you see, this is actually, I will draw these two times, is the S matrix square with just a change of basis, just an isometric, right? So this S square is precisely the reduced density matrix of half of my system. And let me just write it like this. So I can just write this thing as the sum of SK square UK UK. Right? Now it's a state of A only because I've traced out B. And to measure the entanglement between the part A and part B of my system, well, entanglement measures are again a big subject, and in many cases it's not so easy to determine uniquely what the entanglement is in one of these multipartite many-body states. But in the bipartite case, in a pure state which is bipartite, then the way to measure the entanglement is through entropy of entanglement. And the entropy of entanglement is precisely the entropy the von Neumann entropy of the reduced density matrix of my system. So the entropy of precisely this reduced matrix that I just computed. And this von Neumann entropy is minus the trace of rho log rho. So this is just the definition, and we apply it for the reduced density matrix. Because I already have the reduced density matrix in diagonal form, the logarithm of the matrix is just the logarithm of each of the, so taking the logarithm of each of the eigenvalues, right? So I can just compute this directly from the Smith decomposition as minus the sum of sk square log of sk square. So the Smith decomposition, which is just the singular value decomposition of the bipartite state, gives me directly what is the entanglement of the system. And well, the number of singular values that are not different from zero, that are different from zero, is called the Schmidt rank, and the SKs are called Schmidt values. But at the end, this is just singular values of this decomposition of the matrix of coefficients. It's just the same thing. And well, the entropy of entanglement, of course, has a number of properties. It's very important object in quantum information. And well, it has important properties, like it is always positive. And it is only zero, right? So it's zero only when the state is pure. And well, it's subadditive, which means that the entropy of the whole state of AP is smaller or equal than the sum of the entropies of each of the reduced states. But I don't think we are using that a lot. So, but studying entanglement measures is, as I said, a whole part of like entanglement theory, which is a big subject in quantum information. There's a question. I'm seeing it. I'll answer in a second. But for this purpose of talking about tensor networks, I think just knowing what the entropy of entanglement is and its relation to singular value decomposition and Schmidt decomposition is enough, because most of the time we are going to deal with pure states and we are considering bipartitions one by one. Okay, now there is a question which is related to this. So it's a very good one. So when calculating entanglement entropies, we need first to do the singular values for all tensors. But how do I choose where to cut my system in half? Does entanglement change by a different choice of the two parts A and B? Absolutely, yes. So, okay, the thing is that what I talked about here is just for a bipartite system. So, of course, if I have a system of many particles, I can define many bipartitions. And in principle, for each of them, I will have a different entanglement. So I can have parts which are in a product with each other, but are entangled among themselves. So, although I'm jumping a bit ahead about the pictures, but anyway, so imagine this example. So imagine that I have something like this and something like that. So my system is something like this. So I could just take a bipartition like this, and then I have two states which basically are in a product to each other because I don't have any indices connecting them. And that bipartition would give me no entanglement. So there would be zero entanglement. We will see more examples, right? But if I would do a bipartition like that, then I can cut a lot of entanglement because I'm just selecting pairs that are so entangled with each other in different bipartitions. So it totally depends on how your bipartition is. Is the entropy of entanglement?
Marie Carmen, just 10:50, yes. Actually. So you can start taking questions.
Okay. Yeah, well, the people were actually asking.
Okay.
Thanks. Yes, that's good. So, yes, I think so. It's a concave function, but now I have to check. So, so let me just, sorry, I skipped something. Okay, what happened here? I wanted to show some example of a singular value decomposition, but I will just stop at the quiz then maybe. So I don't know if this is maybe clear or not, but we can. I can take questions meanwhile and just leave this up for the break. So are there any more questions? The computational cost of the SVD, that's very good. So it's well known, so I don't know all the prefactors, but say if you have a matrix that has dimension D1 and dimension D2, and D1 is, say, smaller than D2, then the SVD has a cost that goes like the square of the small one times the large one. So this is very, very similar. I mean, the prefactors are all different, but it's very similar to the cost of diagonalization. So the cost of diagonalizing a matrix, I'm thinking of course of a square matrix. So then it's D. The cost of diagonalization, say eigenvalue decomposition, is D cube. And you can argue that it's D cube because of costs of products, say. And for the singular value, it's similar, it's D cube, but because the dimensions are different, it's a bit better. However, the prefactors are different. I would think so, given this difference of a positive thing. Yes, probably. That's an answer to the question. Thank you.
Sorry, I have a question just for clarity. When you introduced the matrix product a few slides ago, what is instead the representation of a tensor product of two matrices?
Right, very good, yes. So what I would draw for the tensor product of, say, two matrices is simply you write them and there is no index connecting them. Right, so now you have an object, say that this is M1, M2, and now you have an object which has four open indices, and there is no connection. So each element of this object, say that this is I1, J1, I2, J2. So if I call this element, this object M, then of course, element I1, I2, J1, J2 of this object is precisely what you want. I1, J1, M2, I2, J2. So you simply put tensors together without connecting them with any index.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. There is a raised hand, Mari Carmen.
Okay, this I didn't see. Let me see. Okay, please just go ahead.
Yes. I have a question about the picture.
Yes.
When I have to say I have a tensor, free indices tensor that has no symmetry. Mm-hmm. I want it to contract with a vector. Mm-hmm. How do I know when I draw the picture with one line in common and two line going out from the tensor square? How do I know what of the free indices is the one contracted if the tensor has no symmetry?
Yeah, no, but that's something that you decide previously, right? So you draw the picture to represent some particular contraction. So you will draw a different picture depending on what you want to do. So you will have some tensor, which is the result of contracting like this, but you could also have a tensor, which is the result of contracting like that. So that's a different object. So you will draw different pictures depending on what the object you want to represent is. So it's not that there is a unique way of, precisely because there is no a unique meaning attached to where the indices are pointing. There are also different ways of drawing your pictures for a given contraction. But there is it is descriptive once you have indicated what your indices are. Of course, I assume that in here all the dimensions are the same, but of course the restriction is, or the condition is, that you are contracting indices with the same dimension, right? So let's say that they are all the same dimension to make it possible. And then from these two tensors, you can get three different contractions, so you can draw all of them. I hope this is.
I don't know how we can, without putting the indices on legs, how can mm-hmm. I know which picture is the precisely contracted tensor?
No, but they are all valid, right? So what I'm saying is that you have these two tensors, and now you could have one tensor, you could get one tensor, which is like this. But there will be another tensor, which is like that. And there will be another tensor, which is like this. They are all different objects.
Mari Carmen, I think the question is more, is just wondering how I distinguish the three legs if they are all equal, okay?
Ah, well, then you have to put indices, right? If it's necessary. So often it is, from the context, it's clear which leg is which, but otherwise you can give them names or dimensions or something. So, yeah, I think, yeah, there are some things that are not defined in a lot of detail in these pictures, but when you use them, there is almost never, an ambiguity. And if there is an ambiguity, what people use is indicating, so labeling the leg somehow, this you can do in the pictures. But, but it's not usually a problem, so. So maybe because now I'm talking in very general terms, it seems that that you should specify all these things. But you can always specify things with labels, so call things differently. There's another question.
Yes, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead, okay, please. Very good.
So the C matrix that you perform the single value decomposition, you need to make an initial ansatz for it, right?
Ah. Well, I was again talking in general, right? So this one. So I was thinking that you have some state that somebody has given you, right? This one about.
Somebody gave you this state, and then you perform the singular value decomposition. Then you do okay. But if you were to beginning from the start, you should give it ansatz for that, right?
What I'm saying here is you can do this for any state. That's my statement. Okay, so given a state, you can do this. Now, where do you get the state from? Well, it depends on the problem, right? But my statement is simply here that this is a unique decomposition that for each state that is, for each pure state in a bipartite system, mm-hmm. you can always write it like this in a certain basis, and then you can always perform this singular value decomposition of the coefficients, which is exactly what we call, or in quantum information, people call Schmidt decomposition. And now this simple decomposition, this singular value decomposition that is present in linear algebra, and it's used a lot for other things. It's like for these low rank approximations and so on. Well, this thing in quantum information is called Schmidt decomposition and has this very important meaning of how entangled the state is. So the more values, non-zero values you have in the singular value in the Schmidt decomposition, the more entangled the bipartite system is across this bipartition.
Okay. I was just wondering if someone give you a state that could be biased, and then my question was how you choose an unbiased state if you were to choose a state.
But what do you mean choose a state?
I mean to begin with, you're given a state there, right? which mm-hmm. should be an ansatz for the ground state, as I understood.
Ah, okay. I'm still not talking about that. Okay. So I'm not talking still about ansatz. So I haven't talked about a guess state for a ground state or anything. So this is completely general. So this thing that I'm showing here is completely general for any state, whatever state, whatever it means, whatever it, whatever, any state in the Hilbert space has this property.
I mean, this like okay. So you talk about the choosing of the states more further away.
Yeah. Like the, I think after the break, what we will, well, I wanted to show an example of this singular value decomposition, but then I will directly talk about how distance on networks are, and in particular how matrix product states are, and then I will be making a choice for how this state looks like. I will do it in terms of the tensors and the structure of the tensors, but it will be a choice. Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
Good. Thank you.
Okay, I don't see raise hand or question, so I think we can take the break.
Okay, so I just wanted to show an example. It's really a simple one, but I think, for people who have seen this before, it's a stupid one, but if somebody has not thought of these Smith decompositions and singular value compositions before, I think it's useful to see an example, right? An explicit example. So let's consider two cases, which are states of two qubits or two spin 1/2 particles with bases say 0 and 1, and two extreme cases, right? So two states that give very different properties. So the first state is we could think of a singlet-like state if we are thinking of spin 1/2 particles, but just for qubits, I will write just this simple, the singlet would be with a different sign, but just to keep it simpler, I'll just write this kind of state, which you can try with the other one. Anyway, so for this state, the matrix, right, the C matrix that I was writing before has only two components different from zero. The one to 0, 0 and to 1, 1. So if I write this matrix, so remember just that I was writing it in this way, ij, right? So just to remember what I was calling the C matrix before. So in here, only the components 0, 0 and 1, 1 are different from 0. So I could write my C matrix as 1 divided by the square root of 2, 1, 1. Where now what this means is, okay, let me just make this bigger. Okay. So what this means is that component 0 or 1 of the second qubit, and the rows will be the same for the first qubit, right? So if I do the singular value decomposition of this thing, you have, in this case it's trivial because it's already diagonal, but if not, you can just find an SVD decomposition in any numerical linear algebra package that you use, and of course MATLAB has one, Python has one, and you can play with this if you want. But in this case, it's trivial because the matrix C is already diagonal and positive, and then this is already our C matrix, right? So we can directly see that U and V in this case are identities, and S is precisely the C matrix itself. So it has two values different from zero, and they are all equally big. So you can compute then the entropy of this thing, and because both values are the same, it will be, well, it's minus the trace of, so let me just write it once, rho log rho. So the eigenvalues of the reduced density matrix is the, okay, I saw a question, I will look at it in a minute. So the eigenvalues of the density matrix is the square of the singular values, so they will be 1/2. So for each of them, I will have 1/2 log of 1/2. I have this two times, and since I'm taking the trace, and then a minus sign, right? So, depending on, so this is really logarithm of 2, right? So if I just do the calculation in this case, I didn't write which logarithm I'm using, so you can assume that it's natural logarithm. Often in quantum information, people use logarithm base 2 precisely because then the entropy of a state like this one is 1, but it doesn't really matter. So you just have to specify it whenever you are doing these calculations, which is the definition that you use. Now let's consider another example, which is, say, a state which in principle looks more complicated because it's a sum of all the components. All the possible elements in the basis, they are a superposition of all of them. And well, in this case, the C matrix has a 1 everywhere because all the components are there. And then you can do the singular value decomposition. And I did it with one of these numerical routines. And then I found U is something like 1 square root of 2, 1 over square root of 2. 1 over the square root of 2 minus 1 over the square root of 2. I don't know why didn't I pull this out. And the V is 1 over the square root of 2, square root of 2, minus 1 over the square root of 2. And S, so the diagonal, is simply 1, 0. So this one only has one Schmidt value, different from 0. And actually, what this means is that the state is a product. And it is a product because, well, the singular value, the Schmidt decomposition, tells us that the state can be written as a sum of, say, the SKs times sums UK, BK. And in this case, there is only one value different from zero. So this is just a product of one U and one V vector. And these one U and V vectors are precisely the first row and columns, or respectively, of U and V. So in the graphical representation, we could write that this state psi can actually be written as a product like this. So it's a product of this U and V, or I could just use simple tensor. So let me see what was the question in the chat. And please feel free to ask any questions you want. So when you draw these diagrams, you have already fixed the basis, haven't you? We talk about tensors, but in reality, these are matrices, right? In my understanding, the lines only have meaning when a basis is fixed in prior. So yes and no. So they are not always matrices in the sense that we can have more general objects. It is true that a given tensor decomposition is related to one particular basis. And whether the lines, the lines typically represent components in a certain basis. But sometimes we can talk in general too, because you see, if we are, we'll see it in more detail in a moment. But say one of these examples, right? So this state can be written like a product, right? So this state, I'm saying, is just a product of these two guys. So this property is general as far as the only basis changes that I make are local. So if I still apply a unitary that is a product of unitary, so a different unitary to each of the sides, the product state structure stays, right? So in that sense, that structure as a tensor network, which is a product, is more general than just choosing the basis, but is related to limited to local changes of basis. So if you allow global changes of basis, then everything can change, of course. So one singular value state is a product state is pure. So one singular value means that the state is a product. It doesn't mean that the state is pure. So what means that the state is pure is that I'm drawing it with just one index, right, as a vector. So anything that I write like this, so pure contains product and non-product states, right? So pure is a vector. So the fact that I'm writing the state as a vector and not as a density matrix is what tells me in this case that it is pure. If it was a reduced density matrix, a density matrix, then I'm again going ahead, but I could write it as an operator, right? And it should be a density operator. And in tensor language, it would look like something like this. But I would need to make a lot of specifications to be sure that something like this is a density matrix. But yes, but the other part, yes, if the there's only one non-zero Smith value, then the state is a product. Okay, very good. So yeah, then I have this small quiz, but I will pass it fast, I hope. So it's a bit trick question here, right? So what does this diagram represent? Does it represent the identity or a maximally entangled state? Or, well, of course, a blank space if it is just this small symbol that you have in the screen. So there's a lot for identity, some for maximally entangled state, both. An identity, both, exactly. Yeah, it's both. So everybody is right. But it's actually both of them. Because you see, maximally entangled state, so maximally entangled state is, for instance, in this particular case, I didn't say it, but this is an example of a maximally entangled state for two qubits. All the Smith values are equal and different from zero, right? So the maximum number of Smith values that one can have is the dimension, right? Or the dimension of the smaller subsystem, if we are talking about a general bipartite system. So if we want, we could write the maximally entangled state as a sum of, say, I, let's consider that both A and B have the same dimension, right? So I goes from 0 to D minus 1. And well, because of the normalization, I would have here something like 1 over square root of D. And this is a maximally entangled state. And now, if this state I write as a tensor, and I do the singular value decomposition, what I find is exactly like in this case before, that the S matrix is proportional to the identity, which is also the property of the reduced density matrix of the system. So I could write this as, say, this change of basis and then the identity. So in the basis corresponding to precisely the Smith values, so the Smith decomposition, which in this case is this one, right? Because I didn't have to change the basis to have this expression. This is precisely the maximally entangled state. But of course, this maximally entangled state, which looks like this, if I do some trick, I said before that how I draw the indices doesn't really mean anything. So I can change a matrix into a vector by changing, say, this leg to the other side. Or in this case, the identity, I could just flip the indices up without inserting any other tensor. And in that sense, the identity and the maximally entangled state are the same. Of course, I'm dropping here normalizations and so on. But there is this mapping of vectors, so this vectorization actually of matrices, which maps the identity matrix up to normalization to the maximally entangled state. They are basically the same thing. So both of them are correct. Very good. Yeah. Okay, so this is the background, part and the basic ingredients. And now we can really talk about what are tensor network states. So tensor network states, going back to the first thing that I said, what we want is to describe states of a quantum many-body system with, say, n particles or n constituents. Each of them has a physical dimension d, small d, physical dimension. And, well, I can write, as I said, this general state as a sum over all the states in a product basis, if I have n components, and I'm considering all of them have the same dimension. Again, this is just for simplicity, but in all these, we could consider constituents with different physical dimension, all of them finite, but all of them different. But just for simplicity, I will just be writing all the time that they are all the same. So this guy that has, of course, d to the n components is a tensor that I can draw as a box with, say, n legs. And these legs will be corresponding to each of the indices. So each of the legs has dimension d, small d. Okay, I didn't write the sum, but the sum here is over all the I, whatever, all the i's. So this is a generic state. So what is a tensor network? A tensor network is a restriction of the states we consider that instead of being all of them, all the most general one, we consider tensors that have a structure. And this structure is a tensor network. A tensor network means that we have a number of tensors, and I'm just drawing whatever here, some number of tensors, and some of them have open indices and some of them may not. this is general, right? So sometimes I use circles for tensors too. And they are connected in some way. So they have a number of indices. I could even have another one here that only has one index, whatever. So when I look at the whole thing, this has to give me an object like the one on the left that has the right number of open indices. So it has the same open indices, but it has a structure. So it can be specified with a number of parameters, which is not exponentially large in the number of constituents. So the left thing, to give the tensor, I need to give all the components. But if I say that it has a structure and it's made out of smaller components, I just have to give the smaller components and how they are connected. And this can be done, so, or we are interested in families where this can be done with a polynomial cost in the number of constituents. So that instead of having this exponentially large description, we have something which is much more efficient. So the simplest example, of course, is a product state. So if we have a state which is a product, then we don't need to give d to the n components. We just need to give one state for each of the n, say phi one, phi two, one state, one vector for each of the constituents. And because each of them has d components, so each of them would be something like a sum of c one i, something like this, then each of them needs d parameters, and then this will be given by n times d coefficients. And still, if I just write it out explicitly, right, I would just write a sum over all the I1, blah, 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 Ci1, so C1, I1, C2, I2, and so on. So I would still have this this general form, so it's the same form as in here, but now I know explicitly that each of the coefficients can be computed as a product. So I could just write it as a product of vectors, something like that. So this is the most extreme example. And so to go beyond that is what we use tensor networks for. And the next step beyond this is precisely matrix product states. So what matrix product states do is, instead of considering a product like in here, consider a product of matrices for each of the coefficients. And so when we say that it's a product of matrices, then we have to say what is the size of the matrices. And then we have to define what is the dimension of these matrices. This is what we call the bound dimension. So a matrix product state is simply this thing. It's the simplest step of a tensor network beyond the product state. And it's called matrix product state because the coefficients of observables and so on as a consequence. So the coefficients of each of the states have a structure of a product of matrices. So I hope this step is clear after all this discussion, because this is sort of the most intuitive way, I think, or the simplest way of introducing matrix product states. Okay, I don't see any questions, so I think it's more or less clear. So why this, so a very valid question in here is, why is this useful at all? Okay, one thing that I should mention already here, I will probably repeat it some more times, but for a product state, I said it before, product state, the cost is, well, actually it's exactly like this, number of particles times the dimension of each of them, right? For a matrix product state, now what we have is that for each site in the system, we have one of these tensors. Now, which means that for each value of the physical index, we have a matrix that is D times D. So we have D times D times D, so D squared, per site. So the cost in terms of parameters, of the how costly it is, how efficient it is to express the state of this form, is linear with the number of sites, so capital N, and only polynomial, actually quadratic, in the size of the matrices. So you see, if we make the matrices the equal one, so the one dimension we reduce to one, we immediately reduce the ansatz to the product state above. And if we make it larger, then we are including some more states. Still, well, this looks like a nice family of states, but a very valid question is why should this be useful at all? Or is this useful? Because it seems like, okay, from the most general state that you can consider, you are going to something radically smaller, right? And well, product states already give a hint of this not being such a bad idea, right? Because product states is actually what you have in mean field theory. And we often use mean field theory to figure out properties of physical problems. So it's not that far from the states we are interested in. We know it's not enough. It doesn't include correlations. So precisely the role of matrix product states and other tensor networks is to go beyond that and to get a better coverage of states that are interesting. And actually, if we are thinking of ground states, which is very often the kind of problems we are interested in, it's not the only ones, but very often it is like that. So ground states of Hamiltonians that are local, because we are often considering physical problems that have a locality property, local Hamiltonians. Then they turn out to have a very important property, which is that they have little entanglement. So little entanglement means that if we have a system, right, so like the one we considered before, and we take a bipartition, and now we consider the bipartition A inside the system, so B is the rest. And in A, I have a number of particles, N sub A. Then, if I just consider any state in the Hilbert, so random states in the Hilbert space, and look at how much entanglement they have, it turns out that the entropy the entropy of entanglement of states of AB, which is like the fundamental entropy of the reduced density matrix of A, this one can grow as like the maximally entangled state. So they turn out to be almost maximally correlated with the outside, right? So the entanglement in A can go can go as the number of sites in A. Well, it would be an A log of the dimension of each of the sites, right? And this is what is called a volume law. Volume, because it counts how many points, say, I have in my lattice inside the region A, okay? And well, these states are like a lot of entanglement. So this is a lot of entanglement. But it turns out that for the states we are interested in, this is not the case. So actually, for gapped Hamiltonians, then what is found is that the entropy of entanglement, and now I'm talking about a particular set of states, yeah? I'm talking about ground states of Hamiltonians, which have this property that is local and is gapped. Well, this entropy goes like the same. So typically we would write it like this, but I'm not using this notation very much in what I've told like this. So let's say it goes not like the volume, but like the area. And the area means the size of the boundary between one region and the other. So the intuitive picture, which is not a proof at all, but is the intuitive reason, is that when our interactions are local, the range over which correlations can be established in the ground state is also local. And that means that if you are very deep inside your region A, very far from the boundary, you won't know that there is something outside. So the only particles that can establish these correlations with B are those close or relatively close to the boundary, and that grows only with the size of the boundary, and this is the area of the boundary, and this is called an area law. So yeah, let me just mention that this is rigorously proven in 1D by Matt Hastings in 2007. 2007. And in 2D it's not proven, but it's observed in many, in all interesting cases, even in some critical cases. In 1D, actually, Pasquale demonstrated that in critical systems that do not fulfill the gap condition, so the proof that I was mentioning was for gap systems in 1D, in critical systems, in 1D, there is not an area law, so the area law can be violated, but it's only violated as the logarithm of the size. Okay, let me explain what this L is. So let's consider that the cut between A and B is regular. So we have a cubic lattice and we cut a cube A with side L, right? Then this is what explains the D to the minus one, if D is the dimension of my system, and L then is the dimension of my subsystem, the size of my subsystem. So in critical systems it's violated, but this is very small because the logarithm is much smaller than the size. So that means that all these interesting states are still very little entanglement. So let me see the question. In the picture for the MPS, the boxes in the middle have three legs. Why can't we see these as matrices? Two rank tensors and not tensors of rank three. Very good. Yes, I was talking a bit, a bit fast in there. You're absolutely right. So each tensor in the MPS, so maybe let me just start another page and draw this thing with a bit more care. You're absolutely right. So an MPS now is a tensor which has this kind, so tensor network, which has this kind of structure. It is absolutely right that this thing in here is a three-leg tensor. We often use for them the letter A, and the open index is the physical index, physical dimension D, and the side indices are this virtual bond dimension, bond dimension that defines how big the ansatz is. Now, if we compute the coefficients, so what is the coefficient for C, I1, I2, blah, blah, IN? Well, this will precisely be giving concrete values to each of the open indices, right? So it will be just taking A1, so let me put the one here, I1, A2, I2, A, N, I, N. The product of all these guys. If this guy was just, say, let me, I didn't write the expression before, let me just write it here. Let me do the picture first, because I'm introducing too much notation too fast. So this coefficient here, so this is all the coefficients, so the left is all the coefficients. One particular coefficient corresponds to fixing I1, I2, and so on. But when I fix one of the components in one tensor, what I do is sort of project one leg onto one value. So I'm removing one leg because I'm just fixing. It's like in a matrix, if let me just give this simpler example. In a matrix, which has two indices, I, j, if I say m, I with j equals zero, this is just a vector, right? This is, then I could just represent this as a vector with this is j equals zero, right? So often I would put something in here to imply the projector, but I'm just explaining what it means now. So is this sort of clear? So in a three-leg tensor like this one, fixing one of the indices reduces it to a matrix. So then I could just write it like this. Is it clear? Is there a trace between the first? I'm going to there. Okay, thank you. So is there a trace between the first and the last matrix indices in the MPS state? It can be, yes, I'm going there. So yeah, I didn't, I stopped before writing the expression of the MPS. So let me just move this away, maybe. This like, okay. And continue here. So what is the generic expression. So I don't write, I think I'm not writing many of the tensors with explicitly with indices also for, yeah, to be a bit faster, but let us write this one. So typically people use the letter A for the tensors in the MPS, and because we are considering a non-translational invariant system in general, I can just say that this is A1, I was using it like this, and this is AN, and the others, well, each of them has this, these indices. So, say, I could write all the indices, okay? I'll do it with, say, three tensors, not to spend too much time in here. So, I just write all the indices. A1 would have I1, and then let's call this one alpha one, and then I will have A2, alpha one, alpha two, right? And then A2, and then let's just do three, I3, alpha two, and then I1, I2, I3. And this will be summed over I1, I2, I3, but of course also over the intermediate indices, alpha one, alpha two, okay? So this is exactly what this picture represents. Now, I could write it in a compact way, saying that, as I was explaining right now, A with the fixed physical index is a matrix, right? So I could also write this as A I1, A I2, A I3, 1, 2, 3, I1, I3, summed over only the I's, I1, I2, I3. Okay, and I'm not writing anything else because each of these guys is now a matrix, right? And this is the product of matrices, the particular matrices that are given by I1, I2, I3. And the first and last matrix are just vectors, right? Because they only have one index, they only have the alpha one or the alpha two. So they are vectors, and I could as well write in this case that this is the same as the trace. But the trace is also more general because it allows me to do something different. It allows me to consider that they are also matrices, right? That this guy is a matrix and this guy is a matrix, and they are connected in this way. So I can make the boundary periodic in this case, in the ansatz. And then in that case, instead of having this product here, I would have a sum of AI1, AI2, AI3, 1, 2, 3. But of course, I have also the index on the left connected to the one on the right. So the proper way of writing this is a trace. I1, I2, I3. Okay, but see, this form of writing it as a trace that I'm justifying because of this periodic form is actually general, because also in this case, I can write a trace without any change, because the trace of vector matrix vector, which is just a number, of course, is a number, so the trace of a number is the same number. It's the same thing. I'm not doing anything by including the trace in here, so I could also put the trace in there. Okay, so there is a trace, yes. When you write it in the most generic way, you can just drop it when it is open boundary conditions, and it has to be there if it is periodic boundary conditions. And this is what it means. Okay, so I think this gives us, I'm going a bit slower than I thought, but I think I still explain before going into the TBD, I tell you how to compute expectation values with matrix product states, because otherwise you still don't know what this is good for, right? I mean, okay, there are some reasons why this is good now, right? So we know that, I still didn't show you that this ansatz precisely reproduces this one-dimensional area law. I will show it tomorrow, but even without knowing this, we can already be convinced that this is an interesting family of states to explore, because, okay, we saw that it is super efficient as compared to the general state in the Hilbert space that is exponentially costly. This is only linear in the number of constituents. But not only that, it also allows us to compute local expectation values very efficiently. And how do we see this? Well, imagine that we have this example with three tensors, and we want to compute something like an observable, say an operator O, which acts on the second side. So I'll just write O, and this means that I have identity on the first side, and then some operator O. So let me just call it like this, O2, identity on the third side, right? So this is a local operator. I mean, if we are thinking of a spin chain, well, it can be a Pauli matrix, but it can be anything that is local in our system. So it has this structure. It's a local operator that acts on one side of the chain. And I want to compute the expectation value, right? So, okay, let me just write it completely. Psi O2 psi. So what I have to do is, well, if I go to the full expression of my state, what I will do is to compute, say, C, I1, I2, I3, complex conjugate, C, J1, J2, J3. And then I will compute the expectation value, I1, I2, I3, of my operator 2, J1, J2, J3, right? And because this guy is local, I can say that this is, okay, the delta I1, J1, delta I3, J3, and the expectation value, I2, O2, or without the 2 anymore, J2, right? I was not using this anymore. Okay, something like this. Right? So I can just write this out and do the sum. But for this, to do explicitly, I will need to compute all the d to the n coefficients and compute the proper linear combination. Now, if my coefficients are an NPS, then each of the C's is this product of matrices, like I wrote before, right? So I can just use this to substitute in here and say that, okay, here I have the A, I could have used ABC, but okay, I stick to A1, A2, A3. They are complex conjugate. I will use the bar to indicate the complex conjugate because I already have many subindices, I1, I2, I3. And then I have the A1, A2, A3, J1. Okay, I could just skip one. So let me just make it a bit shorter in here, because I already found the delta, so I can just substitute the delta. So I can just put the I1 here, and then only the J2 is different. And then this is the matrix element, I2, J2, of my observable. But now in the sum, going back to which things are summing here. Well, here I had the explicit sums of I1, I2, I3, and J2. The ones on J1 and J3 I already did. And not explicit are the ones over the indices of the matrix, right? So you have to remember that the A's here are matrices. So you can also do the exercise writing all the indices explicitly. But let me just group things according to their indices. So I can just group things that are summed over I1, A1, I1, A1, I1, sum over I2, J2. Now I have to put both I2. Oh, I2, J2. Sorry that my twos are a bit like ones. J2, two. And then the sum over I3, I3, three. Sorry, the writing is getting worse. Right. So now let's draw the diagram for this. Let me just do a trick. Because I need a bit of space here. Let me make this a bit smaller. Okay, it's not much smaller, right? But okay. Just make it like this, because I don't want to start running page for this. Okay, let's draw the diagram for this. Remember that these guys are matrices, right? So this is with fixed I1, this is a matrix. And let's write this one first. So this is something like this. When I fix I1, but in here, what I have is this guy contracted with its adjoint over the I1. So you can think for it as, so about this for a second and convince yourself what happened. Okay. This is A and this is A dagger, the A complex conjugate, sorry. That this diagram represents precisely the thing inside this parenthesis. As I said before, complex conjugating, we have to indicate. If we want to, we have to indicate it in the diagrams. Often people drop this because from the context, it's clear that you are contracting a state with its bra, and then you will take the complex conjugate when you flip the indices. But if you want to be unambiguous, you should indicate it somehow in the diagram. So then I have, I'm considering the open indices. So these matrices actually were vectors, only had one leg to the right? And the same thing on the last term, right? So this is A complex conjugate three, and this is A three for a given I. But if I just take the product of these two overall I's, then I can draw it as a tensor network again, right? And the only thing left is the thing that is in between. And in between, I can do the same thing. So I have A2 with two legs and one fixed J2 and the complex conjugate on the other side. And in between, contracted with them, because you see there's an I2 contracted with I2, J2 contracted with J2. There is another object which has two legs, O, I2, J2. And then it looks like this, right? So now I put everything together because these are matrices that are contracted with each other. And this is actually the picture. So let me just draw it a bit nicer, more nicely. So what I have is something like this. So I have my state, this is my psi, this is psi dagger, and in between I sandwich the operator. So you can also see this whole thing here as precisely the product of the identity, tensor, an operator with two indices, so input and output indices, and identity. You see identity is each of the vertical lines. And what I'm doing is contracting, so performing this contraction of the sandwich. The bra, the operator, the ket. Okay, how is this efficient? Well, it is efficient because it can be done as it is written precisely in this expression. I can do the operation within each of the parentheses first, and only at the end compute the result. And if I do that, so the first of the parentheses would give me this object. And this object is, say, let me use green again, it is a vector with double index now, so d squared dimension, d times d. The thing in the middle is a matrix with the same dimensions. So it's a big object, so bigger object than before. But again, it has like d squared on each side. So it's a matrix too. And okay, if I have a longer chain, I will go repeating this. I can have many more like this one. And then at the end, I always finish with something that looks like a vector too. So this is nothing but vector, matrix, 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 vector multiplication. And if I am in periodic boundary conditions, then it's a trace of matrix, 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 matrix. And therefore, the cost of that is the cost of multiplying either matrices on top of vectors for the, say, for the open boundary conditions case, like this one I draw in here. And if I compute the cost of such a contraction, well, as I said, let's compute the cost of the first contraction, like contracting the vector times the matrix. It's like we have to count legs, basically. 1, 2, 3, 4, so it's d to the 4. Of course, we can do a bit better if we use the structure that these things have inside, but d to the 4, it doesn't depend on the system size. And if I continue, it never depends on the system size, except that I repeat this operation, say, n times when I go along the chain. But all this time, I just keep, as a result, something like this vector. Right? So like this vector, that is dimension d squared, and in here d squared. If instead of that, I do matrix-matrix multiplication, a periodic boundary condition case, then I have to do a trace of a matrix multiplication, so I never start with a vector, so I always have a matrix, and a matrix will have, in this case, in this naive counting, it will have d to the 4, and I multiply another one, which is d to the 4, this has a cost d to the 6. But again, I always stay with a matrix, and the number of times I repeat this is linear in n. So there's nothing that grows exponentially in the system size. While if I do the calculation like this in here, I need an exponentially large number of coefficients. So this needs an exponentially large number of elementary operations. And you see this is possible, one, because we have a matrix product state structure, and then we use it, but also because our operator is local. Or if it is not, so this one is local, it could also work. I mean, of course, you could put two operators or three operators or one different operator everywhere. So a product of local operators would work the same way. There is also a bigger set of operators that works, which is when the operator themselves has this kind of tensor network structure. We will see a little bit of that also tomorrow. But you see, there's all this set of operators which includes two-point correlations or three-point correlators or anything like that. So a lot of the interesting physical quantities that we want to compute that can be computed efficiently if our state is a matrix product state. So this is already a good reason to think about how to do calculations with matrix product states. Are there any questions about this? I don't see any. So then I'll start mentioning the first ingredients about the, like what I said, the Swiss knife of tensor network algorithms. But we will, I think, go a bit back and forth when we discuss the properties and so on to see how some of them are guaranteed or not. So this what I'm going to tell you now is really like the most basic operation, I think, that you can do with matrix proxies. Okay, maybe I start with writing the MPS from the Smith decomposition. That's probably most useful. Okay, let's start with that. So how do we write an MPS state from a given state? Well, it turns out that this is always possible. And the trick is the Smith decomposition or singular value decomposition. So graphically, this is very simple to see. So we have any state that we want. So this is really not TBD. I'm going one step backwards, but okay. So we have any state, any generic state we want. And if we want to write this as an MPS kind tensor network, what we need to do is to reduce this to this kind of chain form. So the basic operation that that we use in this tensor network business to write big tensors in terms of smaller ones is really this singular value decomposition. And this is actually what you can do in here. So you can consider a singular value decomposition of the first leg with respect to the second one. And this means, considering your, say, C, I1, blah, 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 I2, IN, as a matrix where I1 is considered the first index and I2, blah, 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 is like a composite index for the column. Okay, and for this matrix, you can do a singular value decomposition. So graphically, this singular value decomposition leaves me with, I'm not using the triangles here just to make it simpler, but in principle, one could just write the triangles all the time for the isometries. So this could be the U, this would be the S1. Let me just, for like consistency reasons with the literature, let's call this lambda one. And then you have, say, this big block that they will call W2. So we have a first tensor and a diagonal matrix that I could, in principle, absorb in one of both tensors. But let me just leave it like this, because it is interesting to see that this contains the Schmidt values of this particular decomposition. Now I have one tensor in the chain. So it starts looking like the MPS a little bit, but I can continue. So I can do the same thing across the next partition in between two sides, and do the same thing. So I will have like U1, lambda 1, and then I'll call it U2, but of course it's not unitary like this, because now it's this thing with three legs, lambda 2. It has some unitarity properties, but let me just go with this argument first. Okay, and we can continue on and do the same thing across the whole chain. Now it means that we obtain something that is really of the MPS structure. So to write it in this generic way with just tensors without the diagonals in between, I can just group the lambdas, say, to the right or to the left. Doesn't really matter. I could just choose one of them. Let's think a little bit about how costly this is. We are almost at the time, so the TBD will have to wait until tomorrow. But let me just finish this argument. How many Schmidt values do I get in these decompositions? Well, this is a singular value decomposition. It can only have as many non-zero values, non-zero singular values, as the smallest of the dimensions of my matrix, because it's limited by the rank. So in this case, say my matrix was like D versus D to the N minus one, right? So at most, this can be D. Now when I do the same thing, my matrix is D times D versus D to the minus D to the N minus two, right? So it can be D squared and so on. If I do this, the whole thing, I could also go from the other side. So I could also start from the other edge and also say that here is D squared and so on. And in the middle of the chain is where it grows, of course, exponentially as I go towards the middle of the chain. So the largest the composition I can find when I split my state in two, and I have d to the n halves to the one side, and d to the one halves, d to the n halves to the other. So the maximum number, the maximum bond dimension that I'm going to get if I do this decomposition is d to the n halves. Okay, but what I find with this is that whatever my state is, I have a way to write it exactly as a matrix product state. This is an important result, but it's not very practical from the computational point of view if I need to go to something that goes exponentially large in the number of sides, because in that case, all the advantages that I had discussed before will be gone, right? So in practice, we want to work with matrix product states which have a bounded value of the bond dimension. And in practice, you decide what this can be because of your computational capabilities. But it's very important to know that if you increase your bond dimension, you will cover more and more of your Hilbert space until covering it all. Also, from the practical point of view, it gives you some guarantees or some peace of mind that your results can converge to the true ones when you make your matrices larger and larger. So, yeah, one last comment about this is that when you find your MPS like that, you have very nice properties, because and this is why I didn't immediately include these lambdas inside the tensors, because now what I have is that my MPS explicitly contains the Schmidt decompositions across each cut in my system. And then by reading these lambdas, I could just read the entanglement properties across each of these particular cuts. So they are particular by partitions because it's only like one cut. And with one cut, I'm splitting my system in two. And if I'm doing this for a system which was not in one dimension, because my MPS has a one-dimensional ordering, it means that I've selected an ordering for my sites, and I'm considering a bipartition that groups it in that way. But I can always do that. So whatever my system is, I can always define an ordering and write an MPS over that. So I think it's already 12, so I'll leave the TBD for tomorrow. Maybe I drop some of the properties which are more abstract. And if there are some questions, so I know that Pasquale had to leave, but if there are some questions, I'm still happy to answer them for a few minutes. No, Pasquale is still there.
Yeah, I'm still here. I can arrive 2 minutes late to the other meeting.
Okay.
So do you have questions?
Or everybody went to lunch already?
Yes, probably after 2 hours they are
absolutely.
A bit tired. So
I can imagine. Anyway, I mean, if somebody, there's some question there now. Okay, that's a good question. In theory, it does not matter how my tensor network looks like. No, actually, it matters a lot because what I said right now is that you can write an MPS for any state you want, but I'm not saying that it's an efficient MPS. You might require this exponentially large bond dimension. So your state might have an MPS structure if you choose the right basis, but if you scramble your basis around, then it will be completely, so if you do non-local transformations to your basis, then of course the entanglement properties change, and it might not be an MPS anymore in a totally different basis. So it really matters that your tensor network tries to capture the entanglement structure in the particular representation that you have. Or in some other problems, the problem is precisely to find the proper basis in which the MPS ansatz is a good one. So it matters. I'm just saying that the MPS has this very interesting property that in principle, anything you can write as an MPS. But if I start with any tensor network structure and then increase the bond dimension, okay, not all tensor networks have this property. This is this universality property. There are tensor network ansatz that are restricted and do not cover all the states in the Hilbert space, because you cannot always write them like that. If you think of one like the MPS or the PEPs that do have this property, in principle, that's a bit tricky if you are asking me about the numerics, because numerically, we often do not have a guarantee that you are in the absolute minimum of some many variable function. you could always be trapped in a metastable state. So numerically, it's very difficult for an algorithm to give you a guarantee. Theoretically, you have results that tell you that, yes, in principle, there are algorithms that would take you there. But it's a different question if you ask from the theory results or from the practical results. From the practical results, you know that it is possible to describe your true state if your bond dimension is large enough. But when you don't know how large this bond dimension is and what are more properties of your problem, you cannot be 100% sure in general that you are in the right result. Now, I can pose your question. So I can put your question. So use your question in precisely as a counter argument, right? If I start in two different initial states, let it be two different configurations of tensor network or two the same tensor network but with a different initial guess, and I end up with different results, then I know that at least one of them was not converged enough, or was not, if I'm looking for instance for the ground state. So I can also use this to somehow get more guarantees about the quality of my result. Thank you.
Okay, I see that.
There is one more.
Good.
But I mean, if you want to leave, I can. Okay, you have to close the meeting, maybe.
I don't want to close the meeting, so let's do like that.
No problem. We can.
We are here, yes.
So. Yeah, we are here.
Okay. See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow. Okay, see you. Bye. Thanks, Pasquale.
Yeah.
So are matrix product states useful to describe ground states of non-translational invariant Hamiltonian? Yes, absolutely. So actually, I've mostly talked about the MPS with open boundary conditions, thinking that each of the tensors can be different. So yeah, that's a finite MPS, and you can optimize over each of the tensors. So absolutely, yes, yes. I missed a small thing. You mentioned that the operator expectation values just depend on the matrix dimensionality. I'm not sure if I understand the question. So what I said, or I tried to explain, maybe I was, that if you have an MPS, that's one ingredient to have to be able to compute local expectation values efficiently, but the other part is the local part of the expectation value. So if you're observable, what I meant is that if you have an observable, that is like very ugly thing, which is not local. It's not a product of local observables, it's just a global observable. So an operator that really acts at the same time on all the sides. I mean, an example that we will discuss a little bit tomorrow is if you take an exponential of a local observable, right? Like a unitary matrix, and you somehow want to do apply this on your state, then even if your observable is something with some local properties, I mean, if it is strictly local, then the product is the exponential is still strictly local. But if it is a nearest neighbor term, and then you take the exponential, then you start taking all the products of these nearest neighbor terms with each other. So you have everybody talking to each other, basically. And then when you have something like that, this doesn't have a local structure. It doesn't really match the MPS structure. And then you cannot use this property that I was showing in here, that you can do contractions in this way. Because if imagine that this red block is your whole observable, there is no structure inside, then you always have like the whole operator to take into account. And that's what I meant. So of course the cost depends on the dimensions that you have in there, the dimensions of your MPS and so on. This is d to the 4 that I was estimating in here. This tells you what is the computational cost of computing a local observable, but to be able to do things in this way, you need, and maybe this is what you heard, you need that your operator somehow has also this local structure. Thank you.
So, okay, maybe we may stop here and we thank Marie Carmen for the very nice introduction.